Happy New Year.
Live from the NBC studios in Burbank, California, the MGM Grand Hotel in Las Vegas, and Times Square in New York, it's The Tonight Show with Jay Leno, featuring Branford Marsalis and The Tonight Show Band. Joining Jay to celebrate New Year's Eve are comedian Kevin Meaney, the music of Michael McDonald, from Times Square, Bill Maher, and from Las Vegas, Richard Simmons with Barbara Streisand. I'm Ann Hall, and now, Jay.
Exciting news. Bob Hurst's mother-in-law is in the audience. There she is right there. Bob Hurst's mother-in-law. All righty. Nice to have you here. Well, let's see what's... Oh, here is some exciting... Thanks. Some exciting entertainment news. Plans are underway to do Death Wish 5. And this one, some Wisconsin fans get revenge against travel agents who lied about having Rose Bowl tickets. Yeah. Have you heard about this? Now, this is just terrible. I feel real sorry for some of these Badger fans. You guess you heard. A number of local travel agents here took their money, promised tickets, and now they aren't delivering the tickets unless the people cough up like 3 or 4 times the dough. Now, see, this is where having a gun can help you get tickets, you see. This is where, yeah. Now, here's a little tip on some of the local customs, some of the out-of-town Badger fans. I know, perhaps, you know, coming from Wisconsin, you know, I grew up in a small town, so I know how you must feel, but I see some of the guys, you know, fellas, those guys that you've been beeping and honking at, I mean, those women, rather, you've been beeping and honking at on Sunset Boulevard, yeah, they're not women, okay? Just a little tip for the Badger fans, yeah. Oh, one other tip. I wouldn't walk around L.A. too much with that Wisconsin stuff on, the red and the white. Just remember, you're tourists, you're walking around L.A., and those are gang colors, okay? Just a little tip. Tomorrow is, of course, the annual Rose Parade. Very exciting. You know what I don't understand? How can anyone afford to build one of those floats? They're all made out of flowers. The last time I bought my wife a dozen roses, it cost me $80. Huh? What does one of those floats run, about $20 or $30 billion? $80. Hard to believe college football season ends tomorrow. In fact, it's also the last week of the regular NFL season. You know, this is the time of year, I think, when a lot of guys look up and suddenly realize that at some point in the last 6 months, hey, the wife and kids left. Question for the guys. You got your new batteries, your remote tomorrow? Got new batteries, some new Duracell so you can click around to the different bowl games, you know? Does that ever happen to you guys? Have you ever let your batteries run down in remote control and then you have to extend your arm like this to get it, you know? Got to go like this to get it to work? Let me take a quick survey. Just the men in the audience. When this happens, how many guys immediately get up and change the batteries? All right, how many guys just try to hook their foot under the TV and pull it about 3 feet closer so they... yeah, that's generally the way. Oh, here's some good show business gossip. Witnesses say today, did you hear about this? They saw two 18-wheel trucks carrying lumber into Michael Jackson's ranch. Now, this is true. Apparently, Michael's got some kind of a building permit. Now, this is really strange. It's the start of the rainy season here in Los Angeles. Michael does have two of every species of animal. He just ordered a lot of lumber. Hey, you don't think. Yeah. I don't know. new research just released this week supports the theory that smokers tend to be thinner than non-smokers. That's what this research says. Well, you know the tobacco industry is jumping all over this. In fact, you seen those new tobacco ads? Give us 20 years, we'll take off all the weight. Yeah. Oh, sure. Oh, those lungs are good for 5 pounds apiece right there. Cut them out, yeah. Now, here's another interesting fact. A study at the University of Indiana has discovered... Now, if you have mice, this might be a problem. You might not understand. Spraying mouse urine around the house... If you spray mouse urine all around the house, this will keep mice away. This is the same principle that keeps most people out of gas station bathrooms. Same type of thing. You know, I was thinking about this. What these scientists say, you put mouse urine all around the house, all around the baseboards, keeps mouse from coming in there. I can understand that. But what kind of signal does this send to your household pets? I mean, your dog spends 8 weeks getting hit on the nose with a rolled-up newspaper every time he goes inside. He finally learns not to go inside, and then he sees you throwing mouse urine all over the place. I mean, what is that? And finally, now, folks, I hate to end on some sad news, but Big Bertha, you know who Big Bertha is? The world's oldest cow died today. She was 49 years old. So you might want to avoid going to the Sizzler the next couple of days. Yeah. All righty, folks. We have tonight... a very unusual show. As I said, we are live. We are going to go now to our friend, the number one Barbara Streisand fan in the world. Richard Simmons is at the MGM Hotel now there. They just opened. There are... literally tens of thousands of people at this Barbara Streisand concert. He is outside the concert. We're going to go in there with our cameras as soon as the concert starts. Richard, are you there?
Here he is. KJ!
Well.
How are you?
Hi, Richard.
Hi. Say hello to Jay. Hi, Jay.
You know, this must be a very special event. This is the first time I've ever seen you in long pants.
Oh, well, I'm all dressed up because... We're waiting for Barbara now.
It's what?
And we're waiting for Barbara.
Now, who is that?
I told you to wait till after the show.
Is that your date? Richard, is that your date?
Let me just...
Boy, this evening really is full of surprises. This is unbelievable.
Jay!
Really? Man!
This place is jam-packed.
Yeah?
With all Barbara Streisand's fans.
Yeah.
She hasn't started singing yet. She's running a little bit late. But I wanted to show you some of the things, some of the souvenirs that people have bought.
Okay.
Now, what is your name?
My name is Rondi.
And this is the Barbara Streisand official hat. And how much did you pay for it?
I paid $25.
$25.
With every penny.
Well, how do they make any money at those prices?
Now, this is a shirt, sweatshirt. And how much did you pay for this?
$60.
$60 for the beautiful shirt.
Now, has Barbara worn that stuff? Is that why it's...
Jay!
Well, I don't know. That's a lot.
You better not be sacrilegious.
Isn't that a lot of money?
Now, look at this.
What is that?
This is the beautiful Barbara Streisand stamp. How much did you pay for that?
$75.
$75 for a stamp?
Yes.
Richard, for $75, that's...
And look what Barbara sent you.
What is that? Champagne.
A bottle of Barbara Streisand champagne.
Now, how much is that?
Hold that.
That's lovely. Have you seen any celebrities there, Richard?
Oh, did I see celebrities?
Yeah.
Oh, you're going to die.
Who's that? I know a lot of...
They're all here. Okay. Now, here I am with Chuck Norris.
Oh, the...
For all those cute karate films.
All right. Yeah, those...
Okay. And that's when I picked him up, and I think I squeezed him a little too tight.
Those are... Yeah. Is that
and
what he calls
look,
them, cute
from
karate
Saturday
films?
Live. Oh, I'm so verklempt. Mike Myers.
Oh, Mike Saturday Myers, sure. Yeah.
And look, there's Jason Alexander.
Wow. There you are. And you've met all these people today.
And here's my favorite celebrity that I met. Cy Sperling.
Cy Sperling, wow.
See? He's not only A customer, he's the president.
All right, Richard, okay.
Of the hair club.
Richard, next time I come back to you, I want to see Barbara Streisand. You're going to have the camera in the showroom?
Yeah, we're going in right now to see her, okay?
All right, has it started yet?
It starts in about 5 or 6 minutes.
All right, you get the camera. We'll come back to you in a little bit.
Honey, I'm like butter.
All right. We are now going to go to Times Square. You see, this is the reason we sent these NASA satellites into space. We can do this kind of stupid stuff. Going to Bill Maher, who is in Times Square. Bill, are you there?
Jay, I'm here.
Hey, well, hi, Bill.
I'm here at Times Square, Jay.
Can you set the scene for us? What's happening?
Well, first of all, Jay, there is a bit of a panic, Jay, because there's a ball on a tower behind me, Jay, and there's a rumor that it's going to fall. So, as anywhere in New York where there's a pending disaster, people hope for the worst.
I see.
But, Jay, if I could just describe this crowd for you, it's 400,000 people. It's like a Woodstock for drunk people with nowhere to go. And I'd like to tell you that it's a sight that every American should see once, much like the Grand Canyon or the Rodney King video.
Really?
It's New York in microcosm, Jay. It's frightening and it's dangerous, and yet there's a great energy here. I tell you, there's something you get from a New York crowd that's very infectious, and of course I mean that literally.
Yeah. Now, have you been able to talk to any people in the crowd, find out their impressions of 93, what they've been doing, what they think, what they feel?
I have done that, Jay. I've taken my life in my hands for you, and I've asked them about some of the issues, and the one I thought was most ironic, Jay, was when they said the environment was an issue for them, because this crowd is about to make a mess that makes Chernobyl look like an oil slick on your driveway. And the Parks Department gave me a few figures about what's going to have to be cleaned up here. Over 3,000 pounds of confetti, 5,000 pounds of broken glass, and of course 10,000 pounds of dead bodies. So it's a bit of a mess here, Jay.
All righty, Bill. Bill, we are going to come back to you in a little bit.
All right,
we're
going to
break for commercial. We'll be right back with our own Tonight Show New Year's Eve Parade. A live parade. To the first annual Tonight Show New Year's Eve Parade, celebrating some of the biggest events of the past year. And I know it looks like daylight behind me, it's just the lights are so bright that it lights up the midnight sky. I'm here on Hollywood Boulevard with our own Ed Hall. Beautiful evening for a parade, isn't it, Ed?
That's right, Jay. It's a little chilly, though, here in Hollywood.
Oh, yeah.
The temperatures have dipped down to the low 70s.
Woo! Yeah.
In fact, the weatherman is predicting a little snow, maybe. You know, but that doesn't seem to have any effect on the crowd here tonight.
Oh, I had to tell you, they seem especially excited to be. Hey, look, Ed, look over there. Here comes the car carrying the parade's Grand Marshal, Dr. Jack Kevorkian. There you go.
You know, it's funny, Jay. Dr. Death insisted on driving his own custom-made car in the parade.
Just beautiful. In fact, the hose going from the exhaust into the car window is made from 8,000 teacup roses. How about that?
Yes. That's craftsmanship, Jay. Well, here comes our first float all the way from Washington, D.C. It celebrates Bill Clinton's rejected nominees.
Oh, sure, from the past year. On this float are some of the nominees he tried to appoint, but were there. Look, there's Zoe Baird, there's Lonnie Guinier. Hey, there's Kimball Wood. Hi, Kimba.
Is that potential reject Bobby Ray Inman, I see?
That's him, and oh. It's a very realistic flaw. You see the women? Those women are the actual housekeepers who never paid taxes.
Well, it's, I'll tell you, Jay, it's good to see them working.
Yeah. Boy, the wind seems to be picking up a little bit.
It's very strange wind here. Jay, here comes the CBS Sports float. That's my favorite.
Yeah. Now, I guess this is a little more festive at CBS before they learned they lost football to the Fox Network.
Yeah, those guys look like they're taking it pretty hard.
Yeah, who says grown men don't cry? Hey, don't worry, fellas, you still got professional bowling, or maybe whist.
You know, Jay, New Year's Eve is...
The wind's starting to kick up.
It is starting to kick up. Now it is, yeah. You know, Jay, New Year's Eve is, well, it's the party night of the year. And so many people, you know, they have a little too much to drink. They end up regretting some of their actions.
Tissue is tissue.
You obviously haven't tried new Charmin Ultra.
Okay, it's a little softer.
It's like cushier.
In fact, it's maybe a lot softer.
It's fatter.
Yeah.
I like
she
that.
Said.
You want to sleep in it.
New Charmin Ultra is so much thicker, it would take 75 more sheets of the next leading national brand to be just as thick.
So we were wrong.
Yes, this symbolizes that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Coming up next is a balloon that is an amazing...
under its weight. Oh, the humanity, Jay!
Terrible thing. Coming up now, I tell you, that wind is really starting to kick up. Coming up now, it's... That windshield factor drops about 68 with the wind. Coming up now is a float commemorating the Second Amendment, sponsored by our good friends at the National Rifle Association. Here they are there.
The mercenary soldier, the underworld figure, the hunter, and of course, the U.S. postal worker.
That's a beauty. No 5-day waiting period for that one. Now, here's an update on a version of a float that hasn't been seen since the 60s. It's Surgeon General Joycelyn Elder's Let's Legalize Drug Float. Can we get that one there? There you go. There you go.
You know, Jay, a little while ago, there was more smoke coming out of that van than Dr. Kevorkian's.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I understand the flowers are brought in specially from Colombia.
Oh, boy. You know, the wind is really picking up.
Yeah, it's really picking up.
Yeah.
Now, it seems like every time we have a parade, the wind kicks up around here.
It is. Jay, this float here celebrates the slick winter sidewalk. It's something most of us can identify with.
Or profit from. Now, this is a tribute. This is sponsored by the American Bar Association. Yeah. In fact, the man on the float is the original guy who Larry H. Parker got that $2.1 million for.
Yeah, sure.
And finally, this last float...
We're having a good time. But, no, the crowd, Jay, is sensing the moment. And when I say sensing, I mean that literally, because they are all blind drunk.
Now, do you like this holiday, Bill? Is this an exciting time for you?
I like it, Jay, because there's a feeling of hopefulness here. I feel a kind of a stirring in the heart. I feel my wallet missing. Oh, my God. Somebody got me again, Jay.
That's New York. Now, Bill, you know, I had a picture of me put up there. Boy, I thought you might enjoy it.
Jay, that's been here for quite a while, and I've talked to some of the people in the crowd about it, and the question they have for you is your jaw actual size in that billboard?
Really? Where, there it is. Oh, there's the Tonight Show billboard. Yes, right in Times Square. There you go.
They think your jaw might be actual size, Jay.
Now, we should be counting down. How far away are we, Bill?
Jay, I see on the monitor that we're 20 seconds to 1994.
Well, Bill, why don't you start us at 10, start the big countdown? I've got my champagne here. Wait, Bill, I've got to get my wife here. Where's Mavis?
Okay.
Come on over here. Get my baby.
10 seconds, Jay. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
potatoes. Mm-hmm.
Here on 11.
Let's go back now to Richard Simmons in Las Vegas. I guess the show is running late. Barbara has not gone on stage just yet, but we will get her when she does. Richard, is that boogieing you're doing? Now, Richard, what's the special surprise?
In just a few minutes, Barbara is going to go on. But, Jay, you know, this hotel, the MGM Grand, was filled with so many fans of Barbara. And I have some special surprises.
It's not
this
one of them deal-a-meal things, is it?
Say hi, Becky.
Hi.
Stop it!
All right, go ahead.
This is Becky.
Hi.
And this is Amanda.
Hi.
And you drove here all the way from Whittier, California, and you tried to get tickets.
About 4 o'clock this morning, they said they had tickets, they had none. So I was just kind of waiting, and a man came up and said that he did have tickets, had me wait for hours and hours, and then got nothing.
How much are the tickets going for, Richard?
The tickets are going anywhere from $800 to $5,000.
Wow.
But because you came, I'm going to give you a ticket for tomorrow night. And I'm going to give you a ticket for tomorrow night.
Oh, that's very nice, Richard. There you go.
Wait. Jay!
Now, they don't have to sweat to the oldies or anything like that, do they?
Oh. Now I have another surprise.
All right.
This is David.
Hi.
And this is Jill. Say hello.
Hello.
And they're all dressed up, and you love Barbara, don't you?
Yes.
And you want to see her, don't you?
Incredible.
Do you?
Yes.
Well, here's one ticket for you, and here's one ticket for you. But wait, we got something even to top this.
What is that?
Why did you come to Vegas?
To get married.
They came to get married, so we called a justice of the peace, Charlotte Richards, who is going to do the ceremony right here, Jay.
Oh, well,
thank you very much.
Richards, even get the cameras to go on the honeymoon with them.
And David and Jill, by the power vested in me by the state of Nevada, you are legally married here at the MGM Hotel on December the 31st, 1993.
Richard. You know,
okay. I think Jay, they should have a little dance.
I think so. I just hope Tiny Tim and Miss Vicky are watching.
Wait here.
Are you gonna sing, Richard?
There. Okay, now let's do a first dance with Mr. and Mrs. Swanson. Big hand, everybody.
Richard, you keep singing, and we'll be right back with Barbara Streisand in a little bit, Kevin Meaney, and Michael McDonald. Be back in a flash. You won't even know where you're going.
Happy New Year's Day! That's mean as hell, isn't it? Okay, here we go. Want to see all my Christmas gifts and stuff? Check it out.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Santa and stuff's getting weird. You know, all the crime and stuff, so they've decided, I got an idea, just put the club on reindeers and stuff, so when they park them, they won't take Rudolph. Club them up! No, it'll take them! Cool! This is a gift I got from Monica Sellis. I put a rear view mirror on it so she won't get stabbed again. Now, I think I didn't do it! I didn't stab her! Don't get mad at me! I'm helping her! Bro, what are you blind? That was it! Okay, that's stupid. I got more. Okay. Look, here's one for Andre Agassi. Okay, all right. No one ever laughed at that one. Cool. Here's one for Martina Navratilova. Look, it goes both ways. Okay, anyway.
What?
I didn't mean to.
What's the problem, man?
Can you let me, y'all just tripping, man? Can I get inside and do my show?
Well,
thank you.
Can I get some money first?
I'm going to get your money, man.
Well, Des, do you know what the clapper is?
How do we get to the clapper? I know the clapper, yes.
Let's do it. Clap on. Clap off. Clap on, clap off the clapper.
Very good. You see.
Talk to you now.
I
am so upset about this.
I write it. Why don't you just go in the ladies' room there and clean yourself up?
Hello.
All right, let's go back to Bill Maher. Let's go back to Bill Maher. And Richard's in the ladies' room. Go back to Bill Maher in New York. Bill, are you there?
I'm here, Jay. I lost you for a minute. I got some stupid Barbara Streisand song on the radio.
Thank you, Bill. Yes, I'm here, Bill. You may not be anymore, but I'm here, yes. Is this going to be a good year?
I hope so, Jay. Just looking over here, we're on the roof of the building. I just saw a New York City policeman take the first bribe of 1994. So I think it will be a good year. And as you know, I did have my wallet stolen, but, you know, it's a time of peace and
And, of course, Miss Barbara Streisand, thank you very, very much. You don't know how hard that was to get. She's a very lovely woman. And we want to thank some of the guests of 1993. Here's a brief montage of some of the folks that helped make us a great, great year. And Barbara, thank you for topping it off with that beautiful, beautiful song. Take a look at the montage. Thanks, folks, and a happy new year to you.
Closely involved with Turkey. After the photo opportunity, the First Lady took the President aside, showed him the difference between a map of Turkey and a picture of a turkey, and then hit him with both of them. As the end of the year approached, surviving Presidents of the United States assembled in the White House for a group photo opportunity. Observant television viewers noted that ex-President Ronald Reagan was absent. In fact, ex-President Reagan was in the White House at the time, but he was walking up and down in a broom cupboard saying, "Where are those other guys?"
And it's just that these Anton Fig costumes get really hot and sweaty.
Oh, well. No, that's okay. At least...
And if you're still listening to me, you're not getting the point. Here we go. 20. 19. 16. 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Happy 1994! Ladies and gentlemen, we have made it to 1994. always a treat. What a scene here in Times Square. You know, I've watched this stuff on television a lot of times. I've never been here before. And it sounds corny to say it, but this is an amazing moment.
Showdown for the national championship. The Federal Express Orange Bowl, New Year's Day on NBC.
It's the final sale of 1993, and tomorrow's the last day. Gateway Chevrolet's tax auditor says we must sell 200 vehicles by January 1st. To maximize year-end corporate tax benefits, we must reduce inventories. New Geo's discount up to $3,500.
Hardworking people across the region.
Have a safe and happy holiday season.
From all of us at KTHI News 11.
Happy holidays!
Get your holiday travel forecast on KTHI News 11.
Tell me about...
On Fox New Year's Eve Live, a world broadcast premiere video from Phil Collins.
Do you like my costume?
Andy?
Yeah.
Happy holidays.
Day sale with up to 50% savings from 9 a.m. through closing. So ring in the new year at the New Year's Day sale Saturday only at JCPenney.
I want to tell you about the most exciting new frames we've ever had at Lens Crafters. They're called Flex-On frames. You can twist them, bend them, flex them. So even if you're rough on your glasses, they'll always return to their original fit. Flex-On frames in about an hour at Lens Crafters.
Ago, and then I lost 55 pounds, and I did it on the Ultra Slim Fast plan. Hey, I haven't felt this good in years. Just check out this label. Each low-fat shake has the nutrition of a balanced meal. What a healthy way to lose the weight. Make your resolutions come true. Start losing your weight with Ultra Slim Fast.
Now buy one and get one free. Ultra Slim Fast. Give us a week. We'll take off the weight.
Hardworking people across the region.
Have a safe and happy holiday season.
From all of us at KTHI News 11.
Happy holidays!
Why don't you and Jackie come over?
It'll be a source of pride to you, another highlight in your wonderful career.
Well, I don't know how wonderful it's been.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to do it all over again, but I've enjoyed it.
Well, you don't have to. You don't have to do it all over again.
No.
Why was there talk of a comeback, Art?
Oh, no. The guy told me one time, he said, how would you like to die? I says, I don't know. I'd like to sit under a tree at the Valley Country Club, drink about 2 cases of beer, eat about 5 pizzas, and about 10 pounds of kosher hot dogs, and blow up.
Oh. Arden, you are a very spiritual man, Arden. we'll see if we can't have a videotape crew there the night that you decide to do that. Ladies and gentlemen, we got to do one more commercial, and then we'll be right back here.
Rodeo.
to Drew Carey, who is going to be on the program and is on the program, but we ran out of time. And by the way, that's what Art Donovan looked like in the 1958 game right there. Drew, I'm sorry we ran out of time, but your big show premiered tonight, and then I guess it'll be on what night regularly?
Tuesday night at 8:30 after Sipping the Boom.
All right, good for you. We'll look for that, and please come back another time.
Love to. Thanks for having me.
My thanks to, of course, the lovely Jane Pauley. All right, well, he'll be in the lobby telling jokes. How's that? Tomorrow night, Sandra Bernhardt, Four Non-Blondes, and Bo Bridges. Thanks for watching. Good night, everybody.
Take a look at some of the ones. Here we go. Here's another tote board. This one's in New York City as well. This one's mounted on HBO headquarters building in Manhattan. There it is. There it is. It counts the number of TV sets hooked up to cable. What do we got there? About 60,837,223. Right below it, there you go. That's the number of illegal cable hookups. There's 185 million. Yeah, a little bit more. A little bigger number there.
Get out of the business altogether, which I guess you think would be a step in the right direction, or start selling more guns, which I'm assuming you would think is a step in the wrong direction.
Or he can go buy guns from another licensed dealer if he feels that the $600 is too much for him. But if we were to charge a lower price, you find the taxpayers are funding and paying for that lower price, because we estimate the kind of study that we're going to make and the kind of interviews and background checking is going to cost about $580.
Ray, was your reason for becoming a gun dealer because you wanted to save the money on guns and ammunition, or because you were really interested in selling guns?
Actually, it was my intention at the time to look in my nearby neighborhoods and shopping centers to see if I might not, wanting to abandon New York City, which I have done, I was thinking of opening up an actual gun store, and preparatory to that, got my license, because then I could shift it and transfer with the proper paperwork. As it turned out, I've not done that, so I'm really basically a hobbyist. I do not make any money on selling guns, but what I do, and this is appropriately one of the secretary's complaints, is I do save myself and my immediate family a fairly large amount of money on ammunition for target shooting, which we do a fair amount of.
This is going to have no real impact on your life. You want to go on target shooting, you can go on target shooting. You
Absolutely.
Want to go on hunting, you can go on hunting. You want to buy weapons and buy ammunition, you can do it. You may have to pay a few dollars more than you're paying right now, but fundamentally no difference in your life?
I agree to that. I recognize it, but I feel that there are the trappings of great crime control here, and
leader of the Aryan Nation, ladies and gentlemen.
What kind of haircut is that?
I don't know.
I can see the three sixes.
It's more like a it's like a cranial 5 o'clock shadow.
Watching another show, you may be paying too much.
This is KBRR Channel 10, Deep River Falls, Grand Forks, and KNRR Channel 12, Pembina, your Fox stations.
From New York, a city that's 99% fat-free, it's The Late Show with David Letterman. Tonight, Bo Bridges, Sandra Bernhardt, and musical group Four Non-Blondes. Plus, Paul Schaefer and the CBS Orchestra. And now, Hollywood's big and beloved St. Bernard, David Letterman.
Thank you. Welcome to the program, and again to everybody here and everybody watching at home. I hope you're having a good New Year so far. Happy New Year. You know, here's something dumb that I've been doing. 1994, which we are in now, on the Chinese calendar, is the year of the monkey. Listen to this. All week, I'm still writing on my checks, year of the chicken. Gentlemen, it's January 4th, so that means the annual New Year's Eve party at the Kennedy compound should be breaking up just about now. Her friend lean over and said, you better applaud her, they'll throw us out. Every year here in New York City on New Year's Eve, they have a big, it's a five-mile race in Central Park, which begins at midnight. And this year, the race was won by a guy named Tom Ansberry, I think is his name. His winning time was 23 minutes, 50 seconds. He finished 8 seconds ahead of the guy who was trying to rob him. Yeah! Oh, come on. This jokes. And of course, on Sunday, our new mayor, Mayor Rudolph Giuliani, the 107th mayor of New York City, was inaugurated here in New York. And today, in a quiet ceremony down in City Hall, they swore in his hairpiece. So I thought, well, you can't. All we are saying. The Big Mac sandwich is 25 years old, celebrating a quarter of a century of serving the Big Mac sandwich at McDonald's restaurants. Coincidentally, this is interesting. Nutritionists say that if you eat one Big Mac a week, 25 is exactly the number of years that'll be taken off your life. So I thought, wow, what a coincidence. Give peace a chance. You know, I know I shouldn't do this. I know, and I feel badly bringing this up, but you're not supposed to talk about other late-night talk shows on other outlets. But I'm telling you something. This new guy on the E! Entertainment cable channel, what a jerk! Earlier today, government officials in Iran announced that they are upping the ante on Salman Rushdie. You know, about 6 years ago, they put a bounty out on Salman Rushdie. He is the author of Satanic Verses, and they wanted to have him knocked off, so they're going to offer $1 million to have the poor man dumped. Today, they upped it to $2 million. Actually, it's $1.5 million and a $500,000 gift certificate to Toys R Us. But I thought, still and all, that's not a bad... Oh, come on! Former mayor of Washington, D.C., Marion Barry, is getting married on Saturday. You remember Marion Barry, former mayor of Washington, D.C.? What an administration that guy had going down there. And I thought this was a nice offer. The FBI said that they would be happy to break in and videotape the ceremony if they wanted him to. Whoa! Okay, here we go, everybody. Oh, come on. Come out here, I tell four or five bad jokes, and the next thing you know, we got a love-in. We got a great show tonight. Bo Bridges is here, a nice guy and a fine actor. Mr. Bo Bridges. Yeah. And an old friend of ours making her first appearance on the big show, Sandra Bernhardt, will be joining us tonight. A great rock and roll band from, I believe, the San Francisco Bay Area, Four Non-Blondes. Now, kids, say hello to our friend Paul Schaefer.
Hey, 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 hey.
Schaefer and your CBS Orchestra. Back home again in Indiana, wasn't that?
That's it.
Now, is that the same as Moonlight's Bright Tonight Along the Wabash?
I know,
Moonlight's
yes.
Bright Tonight Along the Wabash. And I long for my Indiana home. What's the other song?
That's
what am
it.
I thinking of? Isn't there another Indiana song?
Stars climbing all around me.
Oh, no, that's Stardust. No, Back Home Again in Indiana.
Yeah,
what
Back
did you...
Home Again in Indiana.
So I'm thinking it's the same song.
It is.
You know, you got to forgive me. I'm...
What's the matter?
I'm a little fuzzy. Man, it just feels like my head wants a bus open.
Wow, really? What do you have, the kind of flu or something?
Yeah, I don't think it's the flu. Is it the cold and flu season?
It is.
Well, then it could be the flu.
It could be the flu, yeah. What are the symptoms?
It feels, just kind of pressure and...
Yeah? Temperature?
I got a temperature about 120, but it
Whoa,
was...
Whoa, really?
Yeah. Last night, though, it broke. Last night it was 138.
Man.
But it's this, you know what, it just drives me nuts. It's like my head is just pumped full of something, just kind of...
Congested.
Yeah, it feels like it's congested.
You know, I have a remedy for that. I have a kind of a home remedy.
Well, all right, after the show.
You want to give me a shot? Well, can you do a whole show, though, feeling like that?
Well, I'll try.
I could do it now.
Yeah.
It's a quick remedy.
Well, we have the Peace Choir standing by.
Give me a shot at this remedy. See
well,
if it'll make
taking,
you feel...
I've been taking cough drops. I've been taking that NyQuil. I've been eating Vicks. I've been, you know, I don't know that really...
I know. I learned this from a theatrical doctor. It works for me every time. It clears your whole sinus.
You understand what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
It's just my head feels like it's swollen, like it's just going to pop. There's so much pressure and pain
I know
here.
What you mean. This will kind of ease the pain and clear out your sinuses.
All right,
and your whole...
sure.
Come on with me.
Oh, I got to go.
Come with me. Because this is just come with me. Trust me on this. It'll only take a minute.
All
and
right.
You'll feel a lot better.
Okay, all right.
Come on, quickly. Let's go quick. This is a treatment that I learned, and you'll see that it's really like a medical treatment.
I kind of have an earache as well.
I know. This is going to take care of that, too.
Okay.
Place your head right down here.
Like
yeah.
this, okay.
This is going to amaze
all
you. All right, hold still, and here we go. There you go. How's that feel?
Wow!
See that?
Man, it worked. You're a genius.
Just a little thing.
Wow, I feel like $1 million.
Yeah, let's go back and do
thank you
show.
Very much.
Sure.
Woo! Oh, wow, thanks, Paul. I really appreciate it.
I'm glad it worked. Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't.
Great. Thank you very much.
All right, sure. I hope you feel better. Synchronicity.
And look, Paul, my jacket's not wrinkled.
Wow.
We got a great show, kids. We're going to do us a commercial. We'll be right back to show everybody to you. Nice to be in here. Hey, we'll see you in a minute. Problem in America. Just once again to demonstrate to you people that you should listen to what I say because I am right, documented to be so constantly. Today on the radio program, I had a number of calls speculating on whether or not, and I cringe every time this comes up, will Rush run for office? Should Rush run for president?
Yes.
And I've always poo-pooed, well, let's see. See this? And I've always poo-pooed this stuff, because that's not at all, I mean, I never even set out to be a political figure. When I came to New York in 1988, start my radio talk show, all I wanted to do was be a media guy. And the way things have evolved now, I am perhaps the dominant political force in the Republican Party. Who would have thought it? Now, you laugh, but I wouldn't have said that were it not for what I want to show you next. On This Week with David Brinkley, on Sunday, December 26th, James Carville was interviewed by Sam Donaldson. I want to show you a portion of this. Watch.
The Republican Party can't define itself right now. I mean, it is hard to see where the dominant wing is. It is a party whose intellectual force is a friend of mine, a very talented man by the name of Rush Limbaugh. But this is the first time that I've noted a major world party's chief intellectual is a radio talk show host.
So, there you have it. Now, I mean, see, I'm not the one saying this stuff. This is all being said by others, and all this run for office stuff is being drummed up by other people. On Friday night, last week on Nightline, Sam Donaldson is hosting the show for Ted Koppel. He got Mary Madeline on there with Jerry Nachman. Nachman is a former editor of the New York Post, and Clarence Page,
who is a columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times or Chicago Tribune, I don't remember which, but he works out of Washington. And Sam Donaldson throws a question out to the group, and here is how that went.
Quick answer on this one, one word if you can. Does Rush Limbaugh continue to be the number one hot personality by the end of 94? Jerry?
Absolutely. I'm going to go more than a word. I think being a hugely best-selling author, I think being the most successful radio broadcaster in history, and despairing like a lot of people despair about where the great Republican hope is coming from, he may start making some rumblings about a candidacy.
He's going to run for the presidency?
I think he might entertain the thought.
Well, that was a book. Mary, real quick, please.
Absolutely. That's a no-brainer. He will not entertain the thought, but there will be a grassroots draft Rush movement, which he will decline.
Clarence.
Well, I couldn't bear the thought of Rush Limbaugh gloating if I predicted his downfall. So I'm going to agree that, yes, he will survive as long as he's got a Clinton administration to beat up on.
Now, Mary Madeline is a dear friend of mine, and she's been telling me for a year that I should look out for draft Rush movements for president because they're going to happen all over the place. Now, that
failure, but I have a feeling 3 weeks from now, we'll all be seeing a great big Auf Wiedersehen to the folks in Germany. Oh, my. Let's see here. I have tonight's top 10 list in my left hand. Was ist das Haircut? Was ist das? Of course, I am fluent in German, as you know.
I can see that, yes.
Auf Wiedersehen. Haben Sie ein Glas Milch getrunken? Do you have any idea what I said?
What does that mean?
Do you have a glass of milk I can drink?
Ah.
Here's one. Let me test you on another one. Wo ist die Bank?
I don't know. What is that?
Where is the bank?
Where is the bank?
Yeah. Ich haben Sie eine belegtes Broten mit Schenk und Käse.
No idea. What is that?
I have a ham and cheese sandwich.
Ah.
Und eine Glas Milch getrunken. Thank you very much. Wo ist meine Krankenschwester?
What does that mean?
Where is my nurse?
Where is my nurse?
But seriously, where is my nurse? Okay, the category tonight from the home office in Sioux City, Iowa.
Was ist das, Sioux City, Iowa?
Things overheard at the Barbra Streisand concert. Oh, man. This was like the big blockbuster of all time. Barbra Streisand, the consummate artiste, came out of semi-retirement, has not appeared live, has not been seen in public in the last 42 years.
Right. At least.
And decided New Year's Eve to come out and do. They coaxed her out of her mountaintop hideaway.
Yeah.
Coaxed her out with $20 million. That kind of opened her nose.
Right.
So she came out. You'll frighten the Germans. Anyway, Barbra Streisand goes to Las Vegas, the big opening of the hotel there, the MGM Grand, and did four dynamite concerts for like $20 million. Anyway, here we have top 10 things overheard at that festivity. Number 10. One handgun, I hand in 14 guns, and all I get is one stinking ticket. Yeah. People. People who get $5 million per concert are the luckiest people in the world. Funny girl nachos here. Get your funny girl nachos here.
Was ist nachos? Was ist nachos?
Number 7, I'm Mark Russell, and I do a version of that song called You Don't Send Me Jennifer Flowers. Okay. Don't even worry about that one. Number 6, enjoying the show, Bubbles. Number five, hey, at these prices, I can only afford to hear her every 20 years. Number 4, what's Giuliani's kid doing on stage? Number 3, look who's crying in the front row. It's that sissy Letterman. Ich bin ein Sissy.
Number two, oh boy, she's putting on the fake beard. It must be time for the ZZ Top medley. And the number one thing overheard at the Barbara Streisand concert, look out, parachute guy. Ladies and gentlemen, our first guest tonight is an Emmy Award-winning actor who has starred in numerous motion pictures, including one of my all-time favorite films, The Fabulous Baker Boys.
Yes.
This was a very, very nice piece of work. Also, of course, Norma Rae, and his new television series, Hearts of the West, can be seen right here on CBS, and maybe one day, if he's good, in Germany. Excuse me. Ladies and gentlemen... Too much pre-show soda. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Bo Bridges. Bo! Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Bo, how you doing?
Good.
You know, I really appreciate you coming out here, and I have a lot of respect for you and a lot of respect for your family. I think it's a great family. I saw your dad on a movie the other night with Dan Daly, and he must have been like 22, 23 years old. Yeah. And he reminded me so much of you, and it was just a great kick to see him.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for being here.
Thanks. Well, I have a great kick working with him on the show, too, yeah. in my series.
Well, that's right. Your mom and your dad are both on the TV show?
Yeah, my mom, in the pilot episode, she hung me. Actually, she got to, yeah, I was standing up there on the thing and she got to pull the trigger on me and just a quick spot for her. But I got back at her because then I cast her in a movie that is coming out soon that I directed and I killed her in the first minute of the film.
Wow.
Yeah, she falls down 10 flights of stairs. And what makes it even more ironic is that about a year before that, she was on a cruise with my dad and she actually did fall down mm-hmm. 10 flights of stairs.
Mm-hmm.
So it was tough for her to watch the, I forced her to watch the, you know, the stunt lady make that crash.
Well, yeah. Then things aren't all what they appear to be, are they?
That's right.
In
very
the Bridges
strange,
household, yes.
Very strange family.
But last night, I know you were coaching your son's basketball team last night in California. Was it last night?
Yes, it was, Dave.
How did things go?
Not too good.
Oh.
No, it was our first practice game, and I screwed up. I went to a man-to-man defense. I should have gone zone.
You should have kept with the zone, sure.
I knew it. And but it's only our first game, so hopefully, you know, I've got some ideas.
How old is your son?
He's 9.
Does he like the idea of having his dad also be his coach? Is that a good thing for him?
Yeah, it's kind of a tradition. You know, my dad was my coach.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember, when I was about my son's age, I was 10. We were playing for the league championship in baseball. My dad was my coach. I was a third baseman. And we were doing quite well. We were in the lead 6-0, two outs, but our first string pitcher, who'd had a great game, was tiring.
Mm-hmm.
And he loaded up the bases. Now, I was the third string pitcher in rotation. And my father, as coach, instead of going to the second string guy, Woody Christensen, he pulls me off of third base to get the final out.
Yeah, well, now, I guess that's good because if you're not really as good as the second or the starter, this is an excellent position for the third string pitcher. 6-run lead. What can you do wrong there?
Well, I did it, Dave. I walked 7 straight men to lose it. To lose the championship, and I begged my dad to take me out. I kept looking at him on the sidelines. He would not do it. And, you know, I was very upset with him at the time. Yeah, but later on, I figured, well, maybe I would have done the same thing.
Really? Do you think it's a good idea to let a person in your position, a kid in your position, sweat it out like that? Or do you just give him a break and yank him out of there? Plus, you lost the game.
Why did you do that to me, Dad?
No, but you went on to be a considerate. Didn't you play some college sports?
Yeah, I played a little basketball at UCLA. It didn't last long.
You were there when basketball
was basketball.
Absolutely basketball was king, the John Wooden days, right?
Yeah, absolutely, John Wooden.
11 national championships?
Yes. Yeah. And I played on the freshman team right before that string started. And I'll never forget, he sat us all down. We thought we were all hot stuff coming out of high school, these guys, and sitting there waiting to hear what this coach, this old guy, was going to say. And he said to us, we will begin by learning how to tie our shoes.
Yeah.
Yeah, because the basics, you know,
fundamentals, absolutely.
And then 20 years later, my son Jordan attended John Wooden's basketball camp. He was late, running to the gym. I said, Jordan, you better fix your shoes. He said, and so the first thing Wooden says, we'll begin by learning how to tie our shoes.
That's cute. Yeah. That's great. You know, the we're a little nervous tonight. We're in Germany, you know.
Oh, how come you're not speaking German?
you know, that movie, The Fabulous Baker Boys, mm-hmm. You know, we talked about it the last time you're on the show. If you don't mind, I'm just going to show a few seconds of it right now, and we'll talk about it after the commercial.
I know which second.
Okay, here we go, Hal. Roll it. The Fabulous Baker Boys, Bo Bridges, his brother Jeff. Here you go.
You didn't make your move quick enough.
I know. I don't know what happened.
You were slow off the mark.
This kind of thing doesn't happen in German television. We're going to do a commercial. We'll be right back here with Bo Bridges, ladies and gentlemen.
Old buddy Richard Belzer and music of Melissa Etheridge. Oh, that's good. That's the time tomorrow. I like her. She's good. Thursday night. Hey, Thursday night, too. Garth Brooks, you guys. Garth Brooks will be here. Garth Brooks. Philadelphia 76ers, Sean Bradley and comedian CeeDee LeBeau. Friday night, Emmy Award winner Emma Thompson from Wings, Stephen Weber, and comedian Jimmy Alec. And we'll be right back. Some good music right after this.
The night with your dad, and he was just a kid, and it was Dan Daly, who was also a great actor. Oh, yeah. And the plot was a 9-year-old kid is the manager of a baseball team, coincidentally to what we're talking about now. Did you ever get a chance to go watch your dad work? Although I think this film was probably before you were born, but did you ever go on location or to various shooting sets with him?
All the time.
Was it fun? Exciting
yeah,
for you?
Got some great adventures there. Got in on some real classics. I visited the set of High Noon.
Oh, man.
Yeah, and I was very excited about that. And Dad said one morning, he said, you know, there's going to be a fight scene today, and I think you might enjoy it. But it's with Mr. Cooper, and I want you to be very quiet because he hasn't been feeling very well. And I'm going to hide you up in the loft. It's going to take place in a barn.
So you're actually right there where the action is taking place.
Yeah, so I went up there with my mother, and I'm now 6 years old and in a hay. And he said, now, it's going to be a ferocious fight, and it is one of the classic fights. I don't know if you remember it, but
yes.
Between the two of them. And he said, we're going to be rolling around under horses. It's going to be very tough, but we've worked everything out. It's all pretend. Whatever happens, please don't worry. It's going to be fine.
Now, did you know anything about Gary Cooper in those days, or he was just an actor your dad was working with?
I can't really remember. I don't know. Probably not. Probably didn't think he was that big of a deal, although I could tell by the way my dad was talking about him that this was an important guy. Yeah. So anyway, the fight goes off. And it's huge. It rages. They're rolling under horses, and it's all going on. And Cooper, very brave. And at the end, he smashes my dad in the face, knocks him down, and my dad's out. I'm looking at that. And then Cooper goes over, and he picks up a bucket of water. And he walks over toward my dad, and I wasn't ready for this. And he hits my dad with a bucket of water, and I burst out into hysteric laughter. Destroy the take. They had to do it all over again. And then my dad thought he was going to be fired. And we go back to the hotel, and we're going out to dinner, and he's still just so upset, you know. And the elevator door opens, and in comes Gary Cooper. And he stands there, and he's looking at the family, and my dad throws me a darting look, you know. And Mr. Cooper clears his throat, and he says, you folks like to join me for dinner?
Yeah.
So it was cool.
Very nice.
Yeah,
it was great. That would have been a whole different touch for that movie, High Noon, after the big fight scene. Like a tourist happened to be passing through town is laughing at Gary Cooper and your dad fighting. It just would have ruined the whole deal.
Yeah.
And you guys, you and your brother were also in the series Sea Hunt occasionally or not?
Yes, he put our whole family in that show. We did two. I was a jewel thief who, in an attempt to escape, hides out in a storm drain. Mm-hmm. Mike Nelson comes down there to save me.
Now, Mike Nelson was like a scuba detective. Well, that was what he was, pretty much, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. That's what
puts it. That puts it right in there, yeah. Yeah. Wisdom in a wetsuit. Yeah.
And the new show, tell us about that. This is...
Hearts of the West.
Yep.
Yeah, it's a great one. I play a ladies' lingerie salesman from Chicago who experiences a heart attack, wants to jumpstart his life, so he buys what he thinks is this great, beautiful ranch out in Nevada, and he gets out there and finds that the guy that sold it to him has been dead for 6 years, and it's a mess. And they've got to make a go of it. So he's got his kids and his wife out there, and we run into all kinds of wild adventures. And you know, I just ended up in a neck brace from my last wild adventure on the show.
Really, really, what exactly was that? What the...
I had to ride a bull, and actually the lead up to the bull was even worse, because bull riders, did you know that they train, the real ones do, with psychiatrists, with shrinks, to get themselves psyched and pumped? I saw one on the news. He's laying on his back, and the guy's saying, I'll do it my way, I'll do it my way, his shrink. And then the guy repeats it, I'm going to do it my way, my way. You know? So we did in the show, we put a cow right here in my face, like a moo-moo cow, and a bull. And my dad is standing right here, and I'm saying all these things to this bull, like, you know, I'm tougher than you are, I'm rougher than you,
bull. You know?
That's right.
Well, I'm glad the show is going so well for you, and I think it's very nice that you're, I won't say doing a favor, but doing something nice for your mom and dad and having them in the show with you. That's just great.
Hey, I love it. It's a favor to me. My dad's great. He's done about half the show so far.
Great, great. And good luck with the basketball season.
Thanks.
Thanks to have you here.
All right.
Thank you for being here. That was wonderful. We had applause for a commercial, but we'll be right back here.
True Story, rated PG. Now playing in New York and L.A. Starts Friday nationwide.
Okay, I want to thank my guests. Hey, Coach, real quick. What do you think is more satisfying, winning after 41 years of coaching, or would you rather win the first couple of years of coaching?
Well, I'd rather win late like we did. I don't do like Terry, my son. He... First year at Auburn, 11-0. He can't go anywhere but down.
Burt Reynolds, thanks for stopping by.
The story,
nice
Mike, right there.
There you go. Kevin Bacon. The movie is The Air Up There. Opens this Friday, and of course, Ricky and Doug, Brothers Phelps. Let's Go is the CD. And tomorrow night, Brian Denny will be here from Homicide. Actor, comedian, and old buddy Richard Belzer, and the music of Melissa Etheridge. So we will see you tomorrow night, and. Going to read all about the coach right here on Sports Illustrated. Congratulations.
Thank you, Coach.
See you tomorrow night, folks. Bye-bye.
Sandra Bernhardt will be out here. Also, Four Non-Blondes. That's on the show this evening. Tomorrow on the big program, Rosie O'Donnell and Lou Reed.
Ah.
Our old friend Lou Reed. That'll be tomorrow night. You know all about corporate logos and things like this here. This is, of course, the Jolly Green Giant. And when you see this, you think frozen vegetables. That's right. What I think. You see that guy, you think to yourself, man, I got me a taste for frozen vegetables. And then you go out and you buy them. But I don't think people fully understand the significance of something like this, because that represents like $400-500 billion in sales. Yeah. This guy, you know, frozen vegetables, there you go. Frozen vegetables.
Right.
Or like this guy right here. This is Captain Crunch. You see him and you say to yourself, man, I'd like some sugary cereal or something. And that represents like a huge income to the Kellogg's people, if in fact it is Kellogg's, or maybe it's General Mills or Post or, you know. And here, of course, here's Tony the Tiger. Look at that. You see that and you think, boy, I'd like some sugary cereal.
Right.
But you know, what I'm getting at, these things are more than like just little cartoons. They mean something. They become of us as we're doing our shopping. Let's see if we have another one. Oh, yeah, this one. This is for... you can buy those mittens or something.
What is that?
Huh? This is why we buy gloves. I don't know what that is. And here, you see this, you say to yourself, man, I'd like to have me a butt right now. You take a look at that.
Well-known.
Yeah. So what we have here now are some that have been considered for corporations to represent their products and rejected.
Okay.
For one reason or another. Let me see if we have, for example, by the way, was that set up long enough? Okay, here, take a look at this one. Although it is a source of fossil fuels, corporate heads at Mobil Oil thought this commercial character was just too unsavory. It's Rex the Decomposing Dinosaur.
Oh, yeah.
Sehr gut. Before they designed its spiral logo, a NutraSweet was going to be represented by this lovable character here, Louis the Hairless Lab Rat. Nick Zerschern. Domino's thought they had a winner, but he just didn't test too well. It's the Italian pizza chef with the infected hand. I'm not sure what they were thinking at the Pepsi Corporation when they came up with this one. It's Spike the Diet Pepsi Syringe. What could they have been thinking, I'm saying to myself? All kinds of problems would have resulted from this cheery salesman for Ben Gay. It's Gay Ben. Yeah, wait a minute. Let me see this again. Do you put Ben Gay in your hair? Is that what this is? The guy's rubbing it into his hair.
I don't know.
I'll just pass on that one. Oh, here's a good one right here. Come by the house later, I'll show it to you. Okay, we skipped that one. Did you get the memo? I'm calling an audible here. There we go. This didn't sit well with animal rights groups for Goodyear's tires. It's Roadkill Ralph. Look at that. Now they say... Okay. Kentucky Fried Chicken, now KFC, would have made a colossal mistake if they'd gone with this new character, Artie the Clogged Artery. There you go. He's kaput gegangen. The folks in Pillsbury didn't think this was an appropriate mascot. Maurice the Pillsbury Doughboy's French boyfriend. No, that's
kind of cute, though.
And finally, it may have a note of truth to it, but the U.S. Postal Service turned it down. It's Flipped Mr. Zip. There you go. With Sandra Bernhardt, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, nice going. Hey, pretty good. I want to thank everybody on the program tonight for Non-Blondes, Sandra Bernhardt, and Bo Bridges. Just a reminder, tomorrow is Kraut Night. I love CBS trying to get a little of my salary back so they dump it on Germany.
Really? Ah.
Tomorrow on the show, Rosie O'Donnell will be here and also Lou Reed. Thanks for watching. We'll see you tomorrow night, everybody.
Longest tenure in the history of this American television institution.
You'd have thought I'd have found better work by now, right? I don't know. You know, I hadn't thought much about it until today when I was logging in this morning. And as I always do, right after I take makeup, I log in the day's date. so that I can keep all the messages for that day. And as I put it in there, I went, hey, today's my anniversary. And I really hadn't given it much thought before that.
January 4th, 1982.
Yeah, I had just come off of January 3rd, 1982, doing the Frost Bowl when it was 56 below in Cincinnati and the Bengals beat the Chargers in the AFC.
56 below.
The Bengals beat the Chargers in the AFC Championship game, and I had just done that game and came in the next one and did
well, speaking of sports before we go, tell me how you see the Super Bowl coming up.
I think there's only four teams who have a legitimate shot at winning it. Buffalo and Houston in the AFC and San Francisco and Dallas in the NFC.
No Chiefs?
I don't think so. I mean,
does very well.
Does very, very well.
Because they can give you an instant fix on what's happening in your city. Well, that you can't do it.
I think there's a lot of people, quite frankly, who would rather hear about what went on in their school board the night before than the big fire in San Francisco. Yeah. And that's logical and that's justifiable. So I think we continue to tinker with the proper mix of local cut-ins and network coverage. And probably over the course of the 12 years, those three areas I'd point to are probably
big. It's still as satisfying for you. You have the hunger to get there, the thrill of doing it.
I've always said that when the day came that if I got up and put my feet on the floor in the morning and I wasn't excited about doing the show, then I'd quit. I still find something to get excited about each and every day. And I still think it's the best job in television. Having said that, there are an awful lot more occasions when I'm preparing for something or I'm saying something and I think I've done it before.
Yeah.
And that gets but I'm not sure there's anything I'd rather be doing. Does that make sense?
Of course it does. I mean, you obviously, when you do it for 12 years, you know, you're going to see senators over and over, same movie stars doing a little bit, and you can't do the biographical stuff. You've really got to just focus on something else. But, and I don't know if there are many jobs in our business that offer you this one, yours, Letterman in the entertainment area, where you can touch a lot of bases, where you can have a range of people, where you can sit in and have conversations with the most interesting people.
Yeah.
You know, when you look at it each day, have you changed?
I'm sure I have. I mean, I think...
Other than you wear your glasses.
Yeah. I got you. Can't see where, but anyway, I'm sure I have, but I'm not necessarily sure how qualified any of us are to judge how much we've changed, because we see ourselves each and every day and we tend to think we're exactly the same and truly we're not. I think probably it's I'm more difficult to impress than I used to be. I'm probably a tougher judge of what happens than I used to be. Although I'd prefer not to be, I may be more cynical than I used to be.
Because you've seen so much, or because of what's happened to you?
I think probably a combination of both.
Well, who knows? Perhaps this time can be arranged. Tell me something, Sandor. Is it just my imagination, or all the Russians sitting on one side of the room and just the Hungarians on the other?
Yes, my friend, that's the way it is in Budapest today.
I see. And just where do you sit?
Dr. Deshti is the man in the middle.
I simply believe in the art of survival.
I mean, we all live in a fantasy world, and we, you know, hey, I'd like to be, you know, Greg Norman.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can't hit a golf ball like that, you know.
I'd like to be Pete Sampras,
That's exactly right. I mean, so we start with the optimum, then we work down to what we know we can earn a living at and what we are somewhat qualified to do. But having said that, we all reach also a comfort level where you can indulge your fantasies.
But can you tell me you have not thought about options to the Today Show? That at some critical juncture in your life, having touched these milestones, you were there for the giant celebration. Mm-hmm. Was it the 40th, was it?
40th, yeah.
This is the 12th year that you haven't thought about in moments with your wife and best friends. You know, what do you think Bryant should do?
I've been fortunate enough, Charlie, that X number of people have talked to me about other options in television and outside of television. I have seriously and probably will again entertain them at various times.
But you don't think about it now?
No, I'm not obsessed with it. I'm really not.
My name is Rupert Murdoch. My name is Ted Turner. My name is Rune Arledge. My name is Howard Stringer.
Uh-huh.
I come to you and say, Bryant, you are a huge talent. design for us something you'd like to do, a television program that would turn you on and would build on your experience and your skill and your curiosity?
I think I would listen. I would say that while I'm grateful you're not saying anything that Andy Lack isn't saying.
Sure.
And while I'm not in a position to design that show, I probably could tell you some elements that would intrigue me.
Like?
It would have to be live, because I dig live television. It would have to be something where I have a chance to interview, as opposed to go on out and do a video right. report. It would have to be different than the other magazines of the air, because I'm somewhat...
That would be hard, because they're all alike.
Well, you said it, I didn't. and I think in order to be on the cutting edge of television, or be in the direction that television is going, it would have to be interactive in some sense. Now, that does not mean being Donahue and bouncing around. It does not mean being Larry King with a call-in. I don't know, but it would have to lean in that direction in order to take advantage of the technology. That would be important to me.
Do you know anybody that has a job that you look at and say...
and say, yeah, I'd like that job? No.
Yeah. How about an anchor job at the network? There was some speculation at one time that you might like to succeed Brokaw.
First of all, Tom's doing a great job.
And he's very happy.
And he's very happy, and I don't think the position will become
worse. I understand.
Secondly, I'm not qualified. I don't think they'd necessarily ask me.
But in your mind, you're qualified.
In my mind, I don't know if I'm qualified, but I do know that it probably wouldn't turn me on.
Yeah, but people thought that you weren't qualified to do news when you came to do the Today Show, because they said, this guy has been doing sports. What does he know about politics? What does he know about...
But you know what? I mean, and not to demean those who do it, but the idea of sitting there and saying, hey, the unemployment rate fell to 6.7% today just doesn't thrill me.
Yeah, but it's got a lot of power that goes with it, and, you know, you're the guy that gets to go interview the president.
I'm really not anxious to have power. In fact, I'd like a little less visibility sometimes.
Really?
Yeah. Wouldn't you?
There have been many moments this summer that I wish that nobody knew my name. How do you feel about all that? When those people have come to you, and both in terms of the tabloids and in terms of the magazine stories that have been written about you, we talked a little bit about it, but does it hurt you? Does it?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think it hurts everybody. I mean, I think first of all, those of us who do it for a living never got into it to be there,
right,
out front. Secondly, I think in no way does it ever affect the way we do our jobs.
Of you who are with us frequently or just were unable to sleep that night may recall that Frank Gifford was here a while back. We promised to have him return because the name of the book is The Whole 10 Yards, and I think we got about 6 or 7 yards worth. We got all the football stuff, and we talked about Frank, talked with Frank about football in the past when he was on the show, but now we're down to just a precious few before I take my leave, so we had to make sure we got Frank back to talk about some of the things that ordinarily people don't hear you talking about. And as we left the air a few months ago, we were talking about some of the lesser known aspects of your television career, like Hazel and the Halfback.
You know, they still run it.
On Nickelodeon?
I saw it somewhere recently. Or I'll get a letter from somebody. I saw you late night at 3 o'clock in the morning or something. Hazel and the Halfback.
December 8th, 1940. What was the stadium?
Griffith Stadium. Who coached the Bears?
George Halas. Who coached the Redskins?
George Marshall.
I'll put a stop to this. All right, you two. What was the attendance?
Oh, come on now.
Oh, for Pete's sake, who'd remember that?
That little old halfback me. 36,034.
Oh, boy, that's terrific.
Gifford the actor. Now, this is a subject that deserves some fleshing out. We have dug up some clips you folks won't want to miss. This is from a TV show called Turnpike.
Turnpike.
Which was in the mold, I guess, of Highway Patrol with some elements of Naked City type type filming.
Listen, keeping with Public Enemy, another pilot that I had done earlier, everyone thought I was either going to be a detective or I made a good-looking lieutenant at the time. You know, I could, like I said to Jim Garner in Darby's Rangers. The only line I had in the whole movie is, when are you going to get us out of here, Colonel? And I was so proud of that. I went to see the movie, the premiere of that, and damn if they hadn't cut it out.
So you're in it, but you have no speaking part.
None. Gone.
But here's a speaking part, my friends.
Uh-huh.
Watch along with us, won't you? This clip from Turnpike should be of interest.
Poker game takes place in the bank.
I'll have to make a phone call. I had some plans for tonight.
Oh, don't let me talk in any.
Oh, no. Poker games are few and far between. The kind of action I had planned is always around.
Now that is one cool fella. Kind of action I had planned. You know, I was playing that around.
Now you understand what I said in the book when I showed that to Cody and he walked out on it. That's pretty bad. That actually was made by CBS at a period of time when they could make their own pilots. They had eased up on some of the rules governing what the network could do, and that was one of the first pilots they did. It was a real bomb.
So this never got on the air? Really?
Oh, no. I have it. And they gave it to me. It cost them about $100,000.
So this might be the first time anyone has seen this. This might be a bit of history here.
You're right. This will be the first time it's ever been on the network. Isn't that something?
Well, then let's look at the next clip. Fire it on up.
We're making television history.
You're going somewhere?
Back to civilization.
I'll drive you over.
Can you be trusted?
No.
All right, then. Bye-bye.
Bye, Betty.
Bye-bye.
Well, there's the sort of girl we used to call a good sport.
Well, I drove her over the bridge. Is that funny and kind of silly, too? But I had a good time. You know what I really enjoyed about that, making that pilot? It was in 1959. They made it in New York. We shot it in New Jersey. The director, we couldn't find him. He discovered P.J. Clark's in the east side of Manhattan.
Right.
And he was a mess. The writer was even worse. And after 5 days, Bob, I swear, we had shot about 2 or 3 pages out of 30. And CBS, which they should do, they pulled the plug and said, finish it tomorrow. So they gave us a day and a half, so we went over to one of these refineries, and we just shot up all the bad guys. But I also had Charlie Connolly. I got him involved in that as a New Jersey State.
Old giant quarterback.
Yeah, New Jersey State trooper. And Alex Webster. And Alex, of course, all of his teeth kept falling out in all of his lines. Alex and Charlie, of course, with that Mississippi accent, trying to be a New Jersey State trooper. You can understand why it didn't sell.
You write about your childhood in the book. You lived in 47 different places, I think the number was, by the time you were 15, 16 years old.
It was all documented by my mother, and which may sound strange to people who don't know what it's like to be the son of an oil worker who was living in the Depression, and they weren't drilling oil wells. They were just scattered all over in different fields. There were no boom fields at the time, and there was no reason for it because there was no demand for the oil. My dad was a roughneck when he could get a job.
Mm-hmm.
And every now and then, we would go to one town and move on maybe in 2 days to another one. Or maybe even the same day, we'd get there and the job that he had heard about, maybe 100 miles away in Bakersfield, we were up in Colingo or somewhere like that, in little towns in the San Joaquin Valley of California, and the job wasn't there, so we'd move on to another spot. It was tough on them, and I think really good for me athletically, because I was always competing with the new kids in the school. I had an older brother. He was my best friend and somebody I competed with all the time. But when I look back at that part of my life, as I do in the book, I realize how difficult it was for my mom and dad. And in all honesty, never knowing whether we were going to have a meal, how they were going to feed us, where we were going to sleep. You as a father, can you imagine that, how that would be? I can't. But when I look back at it, I get a feeling of it. And I'm so very proud of how they kept the family together, because we always were together, no matter what.
There's a flip side to it, too, though, and it's kind of a poignant passage in the book. You talk about yourself and your wife, Kathy Lee, going to visit your mother in 1986. She's in intensive care. She's obviously dying. And you say something like, maybe we can have another little Gifford for you. And she sits up and says what?
Well, actually, Kathy said that to her.
Mm-hmm.
And Kathy was trying to cheer her up. My mother was a great lady. She was a tough lady. She knew what it was like to raise children by herself, like I said, when she wasn't really sure where the next meal would come from, whether or not we were going to have a roof over our head that night. It's hard for me to imagine, but for a mother to have those kind of concerns about young children, and that marked her for the rest of her life. I was able to, fortunately, take very good care of my mom and dad later. And it's one of the things I'm most happy about, having gone into pro football and earned the kind of income that would help me help them. But I know what she meant. She was thinking, God, not again. And she was thinking of her life with her kids. Of course, a totally different situation for us. But when she did that, I knew exactly what she was thinking.
Yeah, the way it reads is she sits up and says, what do you want to do a dumb thing like that for? Yeah. What's the kid going to do, walk Frank to the Social Security office? Then she says, when you have a baby, yeah, you lose your love and you lose your life.
Mm-hmm. That was how my mother looked at it. It's really sad, isn't it? Because she was a wonderful lady who, like I said, never ever thought of, like we do in these times today, and we have all the concerns of the dysfunctional families today. We didn't have that at the time. My mom and my dad, they kept the family together through thick and thin. Whether we ate potatoes three or four nights in a row or whatever it was. And we did do that. But that's what she was thinking about. And
River Falls, Grand Forks, and KNRR Channel 12, Pembina, your Fox stations.
From New York, buy two, get the third one for free. It's The Late Show with David Letterman. Tonight, violinist Itzhak Perlman, Chris Elliott, and political correspondent Cokie Roberts. Plus, Paul Schaefer and the CBS Orchestra. And now, the voice of the Winnipeg Blue Bombers, David Letterman.
That's very nice of you. Thanks for joining us tonight, ladies and gentlemen. I guess by now you know that the Eastern Third